It is the biggest thing that's ever going to happen in your life. Incredible.
Pienaar. Oh, great play.
It's the full force of the beast.
I want to make a significant impact, and we want to make a difference.
Try and create a safe space to bring people together. It was mutual respect, was reconciliation.
Mr. Mandela said to me, thank you, Francois, for what you've done for this country.
Ireland.
Well, hello Belfast. It's an absolute privilege for all of us to be here, and for me it's an absolute honor and privilege to be on stage with sports legends, entrepreneur, people who do something for society, and we are going to be talking about that interaction between sports and society and how sports can actually make a positive and create positive impacts into topics like peace management, topics like bringing parts of societies together. And I'm looking forward to this fantastic session. And as we are here in Ireland, of course, I would like to start with you, Hugo, if I may. You played rugby for Ireland. And of course, that was quite some time ago. But after that, many things developed, unfolded. So tell us about your experience of playing then, and then the significance of sport at the time in the efforts to build cross-community peace and understanding, and you were instrumental in that. So, and there is that relation to Francois as well, yeah. As I understand.
Absolutely, it's a real pleasure to be here at One Young World, and thanks for the invitation. And I've seen the power of sport to bring people together in a divided society. And firstly, here in Ireland, where rugby has brought people from north and south together, even though the countries are different, without threatening anybody's sense of identity or national pride or affiliation. But also there was a great sort of contact. It's especially a pleasure to be here with these two great world champions. Because when I first was playing in the 1980s, South Africa was still divided by apartheid. And the Irish rugby team were going to South Africa. And the black leaders were saying, don't come and play, don't come and play at the moment until the apartheid regime is going. So I didn't go on that tour. And so I had the great honor when President Nelson Mandela came to Ireland. The few of us who didn't go were invited to meet him, and that was one of the great highlights of my life. And then looking forward and then seeing Francois, little did I know that in 1995, some short years later, Francois would be accepting the World Cup from President Mandela. And it was an amazing scene. And then to see the beast here as well as playing a team where a black captain of South Africa was lifting the World Cup at Sia Khaleesi was unbelievable and was kind of unthinkable from the times when I'd been playing. But I've been indebted, and Ireland is indebted to Francois for something more. Because in the troubles in Northern Ireland, when the IRA put a bomb in Canary Wharf in London in 1996, I decided to organize a peace international. The images of Francois and others in South Africa had gone around the world. So we decided to bring the best players in the world to Dublin and have this match against the Irish team. And we filled the biggest stadium in Ireland and people who were coming for that. But we had to get an iconic leader. And Francois came over, and he and some of the best players in the world played that day, and the guests of honor were all children who had been affected by the troubles in Northern Ireland. A little boy called Darren Baird, who lost both his parents when the IRA blew up at Fish and Chip Shop. A little boy called Tommy Mullen, whose brother was killed in a reprisal attack by loyalist paramilitaries the following week. And a little boy called Gareth Boldsworth, whose best friend Tim Parry was killed in an IRA bomb in London, or in Warrington. And it was the most amazing thing, and people came to that match who'd never went to a rugby match before. They absolutely filled the stadium because they knew what was at stake. And at the end of that match, the visiting team, Francois, and all these champions from around the world did a lap of honor. And the whole stadium rose and applauded them because they were thanking these great world figures who were using their image, their prestige, their status to help and back and support those who are working for peace in Ireland. And so since then, we've been still involved ever since then in peace and reconciliation work in Northern Ireland and on these islands, and the work is unfinished. But we'll be celebrating today a lot of the achievements of the Good Friday Agreement, but there's lots to be still done, and sport has played a role and can continue to play a massive role in this as well.
Hugo. Wonderful. Amazing. Wonderful. Amazing. Amazing. Thank you very much for sharing that with us. Now, you made the link to Francois, 1995. Francois, an entrepreneur, a family man, a sports icon, world champion. That picture of 1995 with you and President Mandela went around the world. So what's your take? How do you feel when you look back? What did it change? What did it mean for South Africa?
Stefan, I'm probably the luckiest sportsman ever to have played sport, to have experienced that moment with one of the greatest leaders in the world. And that whole series of events, sport is profound. It's got profound powers. You know, Mr. Mandela said, sport has the power to change the world. It can unite. Sport can create hope where there was previously only despair. Now, the backdrop of South Africa and apartheid, where a lot of people did not get any opportunity to participate in sport, what brings people together better than sport? I guess music, you know, people go and you watch music and it's fun and it's exciting, but sport is emotional. It's an emotional roller coaster for the players and for the fans. We have the Rugby World Cup now in France, and on the 28th of October, two teams will stand lined up to walk out to play for their country.
Yes.
We were talking about this to Beast. And it's war. You're going to war for your country when you're a sportsman because you are playing for the pride of each and everyone in that country. And so what happened in 95, we didn't understand the power of sport. And I always say this, we were quite lucky because I think maybe the pressure would have been so huge because that emotion that goes through you. Imagine you're sitting in the changing room. You're playing in a final for your country. And there's a knock on the door. And in walks Mr. Nelson Mandela wearing a Springbok shirt. Unbelievable. Just incredibly emotional. My shirt. So it's got this power. You know, if you look at the golf, the Ryder Cup, we just had the Ryder Cup. Golf united Europe. You had Nordic players, you had Irish players, you've had UK players, and everybody in Europe was celebrating the victory over America. It's quite bizarre what sport can do. It has that ability, and Madiba was right, and I lived it. I was lucky enough to experience it firsthand. And I was lucky enough to experience it again when they won. I was there in Japan, and I got so emotional because it was so important for South Africa to have a black World Cup winning captain in the man that is Siya Kolisi. You start getting me emotional here. Yeah. I'm not going to go any further. We'll let the beast talk.
Well, yeah, over to you. Fast forward 2019, World Cup champion. Tendai, tell us about how the values you think carry across from sporting world to peace building efforts. What's your take on that?
Now, firstly, good morning to everyone in the room. It's a real honor to be here to be able to speak to you. And I think, you know, yeah, 2019 was pretty significant. You know, it was special. It was the climax of my career. I retired after that World Cup final. But I can tell you that, you know, great leadership was at the center of what we achieved. You know, I think having great leaders that, you know, had the right vision and they transferred that vision to everybody else in the team and everybody bought into it. And they obviously had the roadmap and the plan to achieve that vision. So that was paramount and key to us being successful and also having team players. You know, Sia was a great captain, but everyone else around him, you know, senior players, junior players, they understood their roles in the team and they executed. And for this team to galvanize and do something special, everybody had to do their part. And that happened in that 2019 team. So being a team player, understanding your role, and the last thing, probably legacy. You know, sometimes you've got your own selfish ambitions. You know, you want to become, you know, the most capped player. You got all these things that you set for yourself. But if you put that aside, you know, for the good of the team, and you work towards something greater than yourself, you know, inspiring the next generation, inspiring the country to overcome poverty, adversity, all these things, you know, then you start playing for something bigger than yourself. So and I think that's what we did, you know, and that's what brought us together and united us, whether we were black or white, or, you know, myself, you know, being from a different country, from Zimbabwe, but just embracing each other, you know, and harnessing the power of diversity and doing something greater than we thought we could ever do.
Wonderful, wonderful statement. Thank you very much. Great. How impressive. Now, Hugo, you actually talked to us about what you did after your active career, you know, bringing people together, bringing, you know, trying to really make a wonderful impact on peace and reconciliation here in Ireland. Quickly, you two, both of you, Francois, 20 years ago, you created a foundation. Perhaps you could talk a little bit about that and how this came about. And then we just talked about in the coffee before Tendai, you also created your foundation. And I somehow, there is this relation to sport, but now it sort of transpires to other fields and other parts of activities. So, Francois.
First of all, Hugo, thank you for taking up the baton, because when you're privileged enough to play for your country, there comes a responsibility. And when you're privileged enough to come to one young world, there comes a responsibility with those privileges. If you've got to put your hand up and try and make the world a better place, and we choose sport, and what you did was profound, because around the world, people were talking about what the real issues are and what the solutions would be. And with me being fortunate to share a platform with Mr. Nelson Mandela, whose main focus was education, education, education. He said education is the most powerful weapon in which to change the world. I started 20 years ago the Make a Difference Leadership Foundation. We've got young Mr. Knight, who's in the audience here from MAD. You promised me last year he'll be here, so I'm looking forward to spending some time with him. So basically what we do at MAD, we fund very smart. I'll share his details. He's achieved 95.7% average in his last year at school, won everything, came fourth in the world in maths. I started MAD, Make a Difference Leadership Foundation, because of Mr. Mandela, and it's values-based leaders. So basically, we fund these young, smart people in South Africa, and the only thing they have to do is change society, change their school, change their university, change their town, change their country, and make the world a better place.
Wonderful. Yeah. Congratulations. And I think that's very important. Tendai, what's your ambition with your foundation you've just founded?
Yeah, so just to go to the beginning, you know, the reason why I created the Beast Foundation is basically because of the journey that I took. And as I said early on, I was born in Zimbabwe, and I came from nothing. And along my journey, a lot of people invested in me, believed in me, and they helped me elevate and eventually become a world champion. So I realized that there's so many other young, you know, talented, gifted people across Africa, but don't have the opportunities, you know, to rise up and grab a hold of, you know, their dream and be successful. So the Beast Foundation is basically a vehicle to empower the youth across the African continent through the platforms of sport, education, and life skills development. And, you know, I'm learning so much from Francois, you know, with what he has done with MAD. You know, we're in our third, fourth year now, and we want to make an impact. You know, we want to go all across the continent and find kids that come from impoverished areas, you know, and, you know, make them believe, you know, help them believe that you can rise above your circumstances and achieve whatever you want in life. You know, you don't have to be defined by where you're at. So for us, it's a big deal. We've got, you know, a lot of projects on the go. Obviously, our academic scholarships. We've got sporting boot camps, which we incorporate life skills in. And you know, it's all about, you know, empowering, giving upskilling, giving young people the tools they need to make it through life. So yeah, it's super exciting. We're promoting gender equality in everything that we do. We've got a 50-50 representation of both boys and girls in all our projects. So we're ticking the boxes, but you know, we're doing it, you know, one step at a time. And yeah, we believe in the power of collaboration, the power of coming together to make an even bigger impact. So if you're in the room and you want to talk about it, come and meet me in the passageway and we can discuss more about the foundation.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Congratulations. Wonderful. Wonderful. Hugo, you want to share an education?
Yeah, I think on the topic of education, and as Francois said, we have a responsibility. So I'm very involved with the Trinity College Dublin Centre for People with Intellectual Disabilities, because it was often assumed that people with intellectual disabilities couldn't go on to third level education, and they have And that's absolutely wrong. And so what we've done is taken the sort of students, they come in and do a two-year course, and then the key is placing them in employment. And we've gone from 5 Irish companies involved to 45 Irish. And it transforms the lives of the young person. It transforms the lives of their family. And it also transforms the lives of the people working in the companies. And it's fantastic. And I'd encourage, I sort of assumed when I got involved in this, this happened in all countries and everywhere, but it doesn't. There's only a few countries that are doing this. But when you see, the young people absolutely transformed, it's a fantastic model that can be shared and can be rolled out around the world. And it's so powerful. But to see we had one young student who wouldn't go out of the house before he did the course. Then he went away. He was sent away to America and made a speech on behalf of Trinity at a world delegation, and it was amazing. And we introduced him to the Irish Prime Minister at an event. And when they were there sharing experiences, the Irish Prime Minister in Washington with President Obama, Tomás, speaking at a conference, his mother was watching her little boy. I thought she was going to absolutely explode with pride. And that's how you can make a real difference in people's lives. And it's so fulfilling, and it's so such a brilliant thing to do.
Wonderful. Great example. Thank you very much for sharing this, Hugo. Now, Kate has unfortunately not provided us too much time. I can see that we are already...
Keep going.
Okay, thank you very much. That's what I wanted to hear. when we now think of this fantastic audience here of One Young World in Belfast, you know, what advice or what learning, Francois, would you share with this fantastic cohort here in 2023 in Belfast, you know? And what could we learn from you and your journey, and how could we multiply that message through the audience here, and related to, of course, sports and the values you are standing for?
Steph, I only prepared answers for the first two questions. You know, as a rugby player, we're not the smartest in the room. Yeah.
You taught me differently.
There's just two things. There's no truth in the rumor that the Irish are sitting on one bench while the South Africans are sitting on the other bench. They beat us, and we hope to see them again in the final.
Well, that's my last question. We will come back to that topic, of course.
Well, a wise man once told me that children are the best mimics in the world. Are you worth mimicking? It's a very good lesson.
Yes.
I got. I'll maybe reflect on, so we bring all our MAD leaders together for a summit every year. When I started MAD, I thought we were going to help 5. We've put over 200 through school and university. One kid through Harvard, he sits on the board now. He's building an aerospace business. He's going to take over from me when I keel over because it needs to be sustainable. We've got 350 kids on the program now. And we bring them together to talk about values-based leadership. And so I wanted to get a message across to them. I asked them all to stand up. And they all stood up, and I said, either touch your head or your tail. And I took a coin and I flipped it. Heads, those with the hands on the head keep standing, those in the tail sit down. And so we culled it until there were 2 left, and then this lady won. So my message then was this luck, or was she really clever? Of course it's luck. So that's the one thing in the world. Luck is what you guys have got and what they got, because they're smart. I said, you know, I was lucky. I was born, if you're a white person born in America or in South Africa in the years of apartheid, you got a better education. You got more privileges. And you were then unlucky if you didn't get that. But now at this stage in growing South Africa in the future, they are so lucky because they were born with brains. You guys are so lucky. You're all smart. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. That's the one thing. But with luck comes responsibility. And so what is that responsibility? And that was David and Kate have been doing with this. Their passion in getting the leaders of the world, they need our leadership today. So first of all, what are you going to do with your privilege? What are you going to do with it? When you wake up in the morning and you look at that mirror, that person cannot lie to you. Look at that mirror and say, what am I going to do with the luck that I've been given to make a difference? And don't think you'll have to do something big. It's like throwing a pebble into a pond. Once that ripple starts going, people see, they see your actions, they see your value systems, they see what you do, and you energize them. The other thing is stay away from energizers. Surround yourself with energizers, people that can put energy into your life. Do not surround yourself with people that sap energy from you. And that would be my 2 points.
Thank you very much. Very valuable. Very well. Thank you for this insight. Now, Tendai, any final words for the audience?
Oh, I think Francois pretty much covered it all, you know. But I would just say, you know, for me, I want to encourage you young people in the room to dream big. You know, there's nothing that you can't achieve when you put your heart and soul into, you know, whatever it is, you know, put it up on the wall, the goals that you want to achieve and work at them every day. You know, it's almost like planting a seed and you water it and then that seed is going to grow into a massive tree. So, you know, keep on, you know, trotting along, surround yourself with the right people. It's key. I think for me, it's done the world of wonders. Having like-minded people that are going to build you up, that are going to, you know, question you when you're going on the wrong path, you know, they're going to hold you accountable. You know, it's very important, you know, and try to keep your circle small, because if it gets too big, sometimes you get lost in there.
Yeah, that's absolutely. It. Great. Hugo. Thank you very much.
Yeah, the last thing, and make one very specific thing, and related to what I talked about before, go on your website and look up the Trinity College Center for People with Intellectual Disabilities. And if you're involved with a university, or if you keep your contacts with it, or you're involved with companies who could provide employment, this is an absolutely transforming experience. And we want to share it. We're sharing it right across the island of Ireland. We want to share it internationally. And you can make a huge, as Francois said, and make a difference, transform the lives of a young person and their families and all the people who work with them.
Wonderful. Thank you very much. Now,
our time's up.
Our time is up. Gentlemen, thank you very much. I hope we could contribute to the discussion. Sports legends, heroes, foundations, education, clear value sets, and the passion of sports which can change the world and make it a better place. Thank you very much, all of you, and wish you a wonderful stay here. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.